pressure. She's running for it. She got it. It's all over. With the knee now. Petro has big trouble. It's all over. Just like that.
Rowdy. Ronda Rousey.
Just 10 years ago, the UFC and mainstream mixed martial arts was solely dominated by men, with women's MMA nowhere on the radar.
When are we going to see women in the UFC, man?
Never.
Never?
Never.
Until Ronda Rousey came along and shattered all of those barriers. Rousey's incredible journey to the top of the MMA universe, for men or women, is marked by persistence, perseverance, and ultimately heartbreak. Her imprint on women's sports is everlasting. She is a trailblazer by its truest definition. This is the story behind Ronda Rousey. Ronda Jean Rousey was born on February 1st, 1987 in Riverside, California to parents Ann Maria and Ron Rousey. Even at birth, she had to fight to take her first breath as doctors had to perform CPR due to her umbilical cord being wrapped around her neck while being born. Because of the complications at birth, through her early childhood, Rousey suffered from apraxia, a neurological disorder characterized by the inability to perform learned movements on command. She struggled with her speech and was barely able to form an intelligible sentence. Ronda struggled with her condition for the first 6 or so years of her life, often getting her sisters to talk for her.
My sisters would translate my gibberish. So they're like, what do you want for a bedtime snack, Ronnie? And I'd be like, blah, 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 blah. And my sister would be, oh, she wants chocolate milk and cookies.
On account of that, her parents decided to uproot the family and move to Jamestown, North Dakota, where Ronda would receive intensive speech therapy from a local university. Many family members, including Ronda's own mother, were worried about whether she could recover, but her father, Ron, was a believer, often telling Ronda that she could do anything she wanted, including becoming an Olympic swimmer. Ronda began to recover from her condition and developed a close bond with her father, but that close bond would come to a heartbreaking end. After a sledding accident left her father paralyzed in 1995, his health began to deteriorate. He took his own life when Ronda was just 8 years old. Her father's death ultimately led to the family deciding to move back to California when Ronda was just 10 years old. Life didn't get any easier for Ronda from there. As an outsider from North Dakota trying to assimilate in California, she was bullied a lot in school. Kids at school would often make fun of Ronda's arms, calling her Miss Man, to the point where she would wear sweaters just to hide her physique. A good portion of her late elementary school and early high school years were spent being homeschooled by her mother, who was also pursuing a PhD in educational psychology at the time. But by age 11, Ronda had gotten tired of being picked on and asked her mom, who also just happened to be the first American to win a World Judo Championship, if she would train her in judo. Ronda's mother was hesitant. In the Netflix documentary, The Ronda Rousey Story, Through My Father's Eyes, Ronda's mother spoke about her hesitancy. If you want to do judo, your mom was always the first person to win the world championships in this country. Everybody is going to expect too much of you. Do your own thing. Stick with swimming. Until one day, my friend Hayward was listening to me have this argument with her, and he says, Ann Maria, nobody remembers you. Let the kid do whatever she wants. Once her mother agreed, the training was on. They would train for hours upon hours because Ronda's mother believed that she had started judo later than all the other girls, so she had to catch up. And sleep? Well, Ronda had to sleep with one eye open. Her mother would sometimes armbar her in the middle of the night, reinforcing the idea that you always have to be ready. By age 13, Ronda was getting good, like really good, to the point where she couldn't train with her own mother anymore because she accidentally broke her wrist. Her mother then took her to a judo club called Hyaston MMA Academy, run by some of her old teammates, where she would be trained by future MMA fighters Manny Gambarian and Carl Parisian. Hyaston Academy helped Ronda learn a more brawling style of judo versus the more technical Japanese style her mother taught her. It also helped that she trained every single day with men much bigger than her. By the time she was 17, it was time for Ronda to test out her abilities against competition her own size, and well, she dominated. She became the first judoka to qualify for the 2004 Olympic Games in Athens, where she lost her first match, but she didn't finish the year medalless, winning gold at the World Junior Judo Championship in Budapest. 2 years later, she became the first female US judoka in nearly 10 years to win an A-level tournament, going 5-0 to claim gold at the Birmingham World Cup in England, and then followed it up later that year by winning bronze at the Junior World Championships, becoming the first US athlete to win two junior world medals. In 2007, she moved up to the 70 kilogram weight class, where she ranked as one of the top three women in the world, winning silver at the World Judo Championship and then gold at the Pan American Games. It was finally time for the Olympics again, and this time, Ronda wouldn't go home without a medal. Despite losing her quarterfinal match to the Dutch ex-world champion Edith Bosch, she qualified for a bronze medal match through the repechage bracket. With a second chance at a medal, Rousey did not disappoint, dominating the match to win bronze, becoming the first American to win an Olympic medal in women's judo since its inception as an Olympic sport in 1992. After the 2008 Olympics, Ronda retired from judo and moved to Venice Beach, California. Despite being an Olympic medalist and despite the fame that came with it, Ronda was still struggling to stay on her feet. She worked three jobs as a bartender while living out of her car, before moving to a house that was going to be excavated after she left it. Later in her life, she talked about how Olympic athletes aren't supported in America.
They should have some sort of scholarship program or something for Olympians after they're done competing, or some sort of work program, not just a handshake and a couple of grand that we're going to tax you on later this year. I mean, you know, I can't believe how Olympians are treated in this country.
After 2 years away from fighting, Ronda decided to make the switch from judo to mixed martial arts. Rousey's rise through the ranks of women's mixed martial arts is quite literally one of the most dominant displays in any sport, and it was all because of the signature armbar submission her mother had taught her way back when she was 11 years old. She won each one of her three amateur fights via armbar, one fight in 23 seconds, another in 57 seconds, and the final one in 24 seconds. After spending only 2 minutes in the octagon, Ronda decided to go professional on March 27, 2011 at the King of the Cage Turning Point, where she, you guessed it, submitted her opponent with an armbar in 25 seconds. After that, she faced kickboxing champion Charmaine Tweet at the Hard Knocks Fighting Championship in Calgary, Canada. Tweet was probably her toughest opponent to date, but yet again, another armbar submission in under a minute.
For a second of trapping an arm, and instead gets herself to the mouth and now looks for an armbar, and she's got it! Ronda Rousey, in quick fashion, finishes this fight with an armbar! Goodness gracious!
Rousey then made her Strikeforce debut versus Sarah Delelio, and like all her other MMA fights so far, it finished with Ronda submitting Delelio via an armbar early in the first round. But the fight would be controversial, because Delelio claimed that she didn't tap, which Ronda didn't appreciate.
My first Strikeforce fight, I did like the coolest armbar that ever happened that I never practiced. I jumped in the air and did some crazy thing, and then the girl was like putting her arm out to catch herself, and like she was really cool to me beforehand, and I could feel her arm popping out, and then the second that her hand touched the ground, that the weight, everything stopping, would just totally blow out her elbow. And she was yelling, tap, 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 tap. So then I stopped and I kind of like held my position. I looked at the referee, just like, she's trying to tap. And then she got up, she's like, I didn't tap, I didn't tap,
oh,
I didn't tap.
No,
and then
didn't.
After that, I was like, I'm making an example out of everyone forever. Because I was like, you ruined my Strikeforce debut and the coolest move ever. So everyone else is going to get it. So every other girl that I fought since,
thanks to that,
you know,
girl,
has to thank Sarah Diego.
So, in her next Strikeforce fight against Julia Budd, Ronda wouldn't make the same mistake, winning by a submission due to an armbar in the first round and dislocating Budd's elbow in the process. The next challenge was for Ronda to win a title. She moved down to 135 pounds to challenge Strikeforce women's bantamweight champion at the time, Misha Tate. Leading up to the fight, Tate was rather talkative, poking fun at Ronda's family and saying that Ronda only had gotten this title shot because she was pretty. Ronda didn't take that too lightly, and when it came to the title fight in Columbus, Ohio, well, she let the armbar do the talking.
Ronda Rousey extending the arm! Tate hanging on, desperately trying to survive!
Make it!
Oh, it's over! Rousey has done it! Five professional fights, five first round armbar submissions! Ronda Rousey is the new Strikeforce women's bantamweight champion!
Ronda had become the Strikeforce champion. She had proved that there was no woman that could step into the octagon and last even longer than one round with her. But there were still hurdles she had to battle, mainly trying to get into the UFC.
When are we gonna see women in the UFC, man?
Never.
Obviously, Dana White would have a change of heart. Not even a year later, Rousey had signed to the UFC.
Bring the champ out here. I'm going to make it official right now. The first ever UFC Women's Champion, Ronda Rousey. She'll be fighting Liz Carmouche, and she is the main event.
But unknowingly, the UFC had put an immense amount of pressure onto Ronda. Dana White had given Rousey the title of champion without Ronda even having to fight for it. Now, Rowdy Ronda Rousey, who had finally embraced the nickname of former pro wrestler Roddy Piper, with his permission of course, would make her debut at UFC 157 against Liz Carmouche. Carmouche was competitive, even catching Rousey in a neck crank which dislocated her jaw, but surely enough, like all the fights she had won before, Ronda did it again.
This is the armbar position. She's got her in a spider web.
Lock it in. More pressure.
She's running for it. She got it. It's all over.
The main event catapulted Rousey into stardom. She starred as herself in the Entourage movie, and then joined more action-packed movies in Expendables 3 and Fast and Furious 7. Most importantly, she became a symbol for body empowerment, appearing nude on the cover of ESPN Magazine's 2012 body issue, and spoke about her own struggles with eating disorders, hoping to shed light on the issue with her organization, Don't Throw Up, Throw Down. In her self-titled documentary, she said, "I always thought that eating disorders were constantly being overlooked. It was something that I suffered with when I was younger. It breaks my heart when there's 11 and 12 year olds that come up to me and think they look fat. So then we came up with Don't Throw Up, Throw Down." Ronda's next fight would be a rematch with her highly touted rival Misha Tate. But between her film commitments, she only had 45 days to train for the fight. In what was her first fight that went past the first round, Ronda submitted Tate via armbar in the third round to retain her bantamweight championship. And it was clear, even after the fight, that there was no love lost. Ronda didn't shake Tate's hand after the fight, which led to a chorus of boos.
Give us your thoughts on it.
Well, first of all, I need to come in and congratulate Misha. She's an amazing fighter, she really is. It's just, once you insult my family, I can't shake your hand, but I really respect her and I think she did an amazing job tonight.
Despite her impeccable record, Rousey still had doubters who claimed the only thing she could do was grapple her opponent and submit them with an armbar. She dispelled that notion when she knocked out Sarah McMahon in just over 1 minute at UFC 170, and then followed it up by knocking out Alexis Davis in 16 seconds 2 months later, despite suffering a broken thumb during the fight.
And a big throwdown! Right
Can
away.
She do it right here?
That's
and
it.
It's all over! Just like that!
She submitted Kat Zingano with an armbar just 14 seconds into the fight at UFC 182, which was the shortest match in UFC championship history until Conor McGregor defeated Jose Aldo in 13 seconds 1 year later. Rousey then traveled to Brazil to take on Phenom Betch Correa on Correa's home turf. Before the fight, Correa poked fun at Rousey's father's suicide, but Rousey would make Correa eat her words.
Ronda's teeing off on her here.
Ronda trying to finish it. She's in trouble. Ronda with the knee now. Betch Correa has big trouble. It's all over. Just like that.
Through her six UFC bouts, all of which had been victories, Ronda had only spent 1,077 seconds in the octagon and accumulated over $1 million in prize money, which means every second she spent fighting, she made $1,000. Her average fight time of 2 minutes and 59 seconds was less than the average time of a single match in every UFC weight class. Through her 3-year run, Rousey was as dominant as ever. There weren't any women that could touch her. She had also paved the way for the women's game to grow and become more competitive. Essentially, while Ronda was busy winning, the rest of the world was busy catching up. In her 7th title defense, Rousey would face Holly Holm at UFC 193. Despite Ronda's impeccable record, Holm was her toughest competition to date, who could potentially expose Ronda's biggest weakness. Holm was a talented striker who was also undefeated heading into the fight, winning 6 of her 8 contests by a knockout. And despite Rousey being a heavy favorite going into the fight, she truly had no answers for Holm's superior striking.
Beautiful.
Can she
Beautiful.
Connect?
She's hurt.
Ronda's in trouble.
She's hurt.
Hey, oh. Holly looking to finish.
He's out.
Holly Holm is the new UFC bantamweight champion of the world.
Oh my God.
Holm's victory was a shock to everyone. Rousey was a shoo-in to win, making this one of the biggest upsets in UFC history. Rousey was beaten up so bad that she wasn't medically cleared to train for 6 months after the fight. When Rousey appeared on the Ellen DeGeneres show, she spoke on the struggles she went through following her first career loss.
I was like in the medical room, and I was like down in the corner, I was sitting in the corner, and I was like, what am I anymore if I'm not this? And I was literally sitting there and like thinking about killing myself in that exact second. I'm like, I'm nothing. I'm like, what do I do anymore? And no one gives a shit about me anymore without this. And to be honest, I looked up and I saw my man, Travis, was standing there, and I was looking up at him, and I was just like, I need to have his babies. I need to stay alive.
After a year away from the sport, Rousey returned to the UFC, setting up a highly anticipated title bout with the current champion Amanda Nunes. Nunes had just relieved Rousey's arch rival Miesha Tate, who, funny enough, had beaten home to win the bantamweight title just a few months before. Leading up to the fight, Rousey was asked about her motivation to return to the octagon, to which she said, I want to be able to walk away with my head held high. I don't want good enough to be my legacy. The fight was highly anticipated, racking up the most pay-per-view purchases for any women's combat fight ever. Nunes, now widely regarded as the greatest women's fighter ever, showed that Ronda's best days were behind her.
Nunes' hands are down, and she's walking Ronda down. She tags her again, over and over. Amanda Nunes! Big combination! It's over! Wow!
While she never formally retired, after stepping away from the UFC, Ronda set her sights on the world of professional wrestling, following in the footsteps of her idol Rowdy Roddy Piper. She made sporadic appearances between 2014 and 2017, before making a surprise appearance at Royal Rumble in 2018. Wearing Rowdy Piper's iconic jacket and confronting Raw Women's Champion Alexis Bliss in the process. And just 6 months later, she would dominate Bliss at SummerSlam to win the Raw Women's Championship and kept the title for 231 days before losing it to Becky Lynch in a triple threat match as the main event at WrestleMania, making it the first women's match to ever close out the event.
Shoulders down!
Becky Lynch is the winner, take all, and is both Raw and SmackDown Women's Champion!
And while her pro wrestling career was successful for the most part, fans of the sport don't appreciate her because she called it fake.
What am I doing it for if I am not being able to spend my time and my energy on my family, but instead spending my time on energy on a bunch of fucking ungrateful fans that don't even appreciate me.
Post-retirement, Ronda is enjoying family life. Now married to former UFC fighter Travis Brown, in April, the couple made a special announcement.
Pow, 4 months pregnant. Oh, what? You didn't even know. Last 4 months. Woo.
Through Ronda Rousey's career, she's become a decorated judoka, winning gold 3 times, silver twice, and bronze twice, including becoming an Olympic medalist. She finished her UFC career with a record 12-2, and she was one of the greatest submission artists to ever step in the octagon. The women's game can't be mentioned without bringing up Ronda Rousey. She paved the way for the mainstream fighters we see today, like Amanda Nunes, Rose Namajunas, and Valentina Shevchenko. She is a trailblazer in the truest form, and helped show that women could aspire to be whatever they choose to be in this world.
Thanks for watching. If you like this video and want to see more content like this, hit that subscribe button.